from Nashville, Tennessee. It's time for another episode of Tips, Tactics, and Tools for a Safer Tomorrow, where all things related to your safety and security are discussed, detailed, and delivered to you. You may leave with a tip that saves you money or a tactic that saves your life. So here are your hosts, owner and founder of Defend Systems, Brink Fiddler, and owner and operator of Herring Technology, Tom Herring.
Hey everybody, welcome to this edition of Tips, Tactics, and Tools for a Safer Tomorrow. As evidenced by our obvious intro, I'm Brink Fiddler with my co-host Tom Herring and founder of the podcast and owner and operator of Herring Technology. Today we are honored to have Randy Atlas as our guest. Randy is, we were just discussing this off air, a unicorn in that he is the only PhD criminologist as well as architect. He is a fellow with the American Institute of Architects. His company is Atlas Safety and Security Design Incorporated out of Florida. He specializes in crime prevention through environmental design and threat assessments and securing buildings, designing security on the front end, retrofitting on the back end. He does a lot of what Tom and I do, and he problem solves for people and guides them on how to do it for a much smaller amount of money on the front end than trying to come back and retrofit on the back end. So, Randy, thanks for being here and thanks for coming on the podcast.
Thank you for having me. Happy to be here in Nashville.
So, just so everybody understands what this day has been about, we just finished a webinar just because we're in the world of COVID and we couldn't do a seminar this year for Tennessee Higher Education Commission on safety and security. So I was blessed and honored to speak this morning, and as was Randy came into town for that in order to present to the different police chiefs and security people, I think probably some university faculty and administration from across Tennessee. And because of certain orders and state buildings being closed, we ended up doing the webinar from here in the treehouse, also known as the podcast studio, also known as the conference room, and now also known as the webinar broadcast platform. So a little background there. So, Randy, if you will, tell us, I mean, obviously you had interest in architecture, so you became an architect, but how did you become the CPTED guy? Like, how does this all work?
When I was in high school in Miami Beach, my uncle was the chief of police of Miami Beach, Rocky Pomerantz, who was a legend of his time in the 1960s because the 1968 Democratic and Republican conventions was held in Miami Beach Convention Center.
Oh, wow.
And he had been well-read about defensible space in CPTED and had used a lot of those techniques to have two successful political conventions in our hometown without riots, without people getting injured, without mass casualties or arrests. And frankly, he used humor and CPTED to pacify the political upheavals, and 1968 was about as politically divisive as we are right now in 2020.
Real quick, but for people listening, you and I keep talking about CPTED. Most people that listen to this won't have any idea what that is. Just go with that real quick.
Crime prevention through environmental design is the design of the built environment to reduce the opportunity and fear of crime in the environment, and as a result, improve the quality of life of where we live, work, and play, and reduce the opportunities for the criminalistic opportunities in the built environment. And I'll get back to that just in just a second.
Yep.
And when I was a senior in high school, I went, because I was sort of had an interest in law enforcement, so I always was sort of steering in that direction, but I really didn't want to be a police officer because I don't play well with others, and I was never one to join the military or police departments or have a partner. I just generally don't, you know, like being around people that much.
That's awesome. Oh, by the way, welcome to the podcast.
He's an architect.
And interestingly enough, most architects are sort of fit that personality profile. They play in the sandbox by themselves.
Kind of an introvert, most of them. You're not an introvert.
I'm not an introvert, but I mean, you know, I play with the log cabin, you know, kits and with Legos, and I would just do things to humor myself. I wasn't into team sports, you know, basketball, football, and, you know, so I had to learn to entertain and humor myself.
Yeah.
And so when I met my uncle, the chief of police, he gave me Oscar Newman's book, Defensible Space, about crime prevention through urban design. And it had been written by Oscar Newman, who was an urban planner. This is around 1969, 1970. when I graduated high school, and I read that book and I thought, oh, that's interesting, because I'm really good at drawing and was, you know, doing all my, you know, building sandcastles and log cabins and Lego things. And so I liked design and I liked to build, but I didn't know where I fit in. And now all of a sudden I found, like, oh, there's a place for me where I can have an interest in law enforcement and security and also architecture and design and drawing and being creative. Fast forward, I went to University of Florida to architecture school, and all my electives that I took were in sociology, criminal justice, criminology, public administration, things of that nature. So I was building up a sort of a repertoire in sort of another field while I was taking my typical architecture design courses. By the time I had to go, oh, and while I was at the University of Florida, Oscar Newman came to Gainesville and spoke at the university, at the School of Architecture. So I actually got to hear Oscar Newman speak in person about 1972 or 3, and just a couple years after he'd come out with his book. Well, I was enthralled by that. And as a result, when I went to do my Master's of Architecture at the University of Illinois, they had a program at the, that was about designing criminal justice facilities. It was a program called the National Clearinghouse for Criminal Justice Planning and Architecture that had been funded by the Law Enforcement Administration, or the funding from the Department of Justice at that time in the early 70s, to come up with an entirely new design concept for how we design police stations, jails, prisons, and courthouses. And I was right there as sort of a research assistant, graduate student, working, you know, as a graduate student for this institute and working my Master's of Architecture. Simultaneously, I find out that there's an instructor in the Industrial Design Department at the University of Illinois in Champaign-Urbana that was teaching a course in CPTED, Crime Prevention Through Environmental Design, and he was part of this Westinghouse program that had been funded by the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration to do prototype security design for schools, residential facilities, commercial facilities, and there was like four or five test sites that were being tested in the early 70s about how design could impact crime and security and safety. And I became his teaching assistant and learned CPTED through this project manager who was had been working with the Westinghouse program. I graduate in 1976 from my Master's of Architecture. And by that time, I'm still taking elective courses in criminal justice and criminology. By the time I finish my master's, I'm just one or two hours short of getting a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. So during the summers, I go to Tampa, University of South Florida, and I finish in one semester my requirements for getting a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. So now I have a bachelor's of architecture, a master's of architecture, and a bachelor's of criminal justice. And I figured, great, I'm ready to go out and get a job, go to church, pay taxes, make something of myself.
Yeah.
Wrong, Buffy.
Buffy.
I get an invite from C. Ray Jeffrey, who would ultimately write the book in 1970 on crime prevention through environmental design from Florida State University School of Criminology. Please come and do a PhD in criminology. And I'm going, why? I've been in college for 6 years now. I need to start earning my money because my parents are telling me they will no longer support me. I'm now 45 years old, and enough is enough.
But you would fit right in today's society.
Absolutely. Right. Just a failure to launch slacker like most of the young people.
Mom's basement.
Yeah. And you're waiting for them to die so I can acquire the real estate. Yes. And so I decide, great, if I can figure out a way how to support myself, I will go to Florida State and work on my PhD. So I apply to the school. They're thrilled to have me. C. Ray Jeffrey sponsors me, and I get accepted. I start school, and I work for the Florida Department of Corrections as an architectural intern during the day, and then I'm doing my PhD work at night. And as a sideline, when I was at the University of Illinois, I learned ballroom dancing. And by the time I got to Florida State University...
I'm sorry, do we have a sound effect, Jim? Do we have one of those anywhere?
We have a...
some salsa dancing?
I mean...
I'm going to scratch there.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
So I learned ballroom dancing proficiently when I was at University of Illinois working in my master's. And by the time I started Florida State, it was 1976. It was in the peak of disco. Back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
So I started the FSU Ballroom Dance Club, and
You can't make this up, man.
I told you we had a unicorn.
Wait, it gets better.
Randy.
So I'm literally working for the Department of Corrections during the day, doing my PhD work in the evenings, and one or two nights a week I'm teaching ballroom dance at the university, and my classes are growing exponentially, sort of like COVID.
Low death rates.
And
where's the rim shot, bro?
Bada boom.
No, we got
a little ballroom music.
Yeah. A little waltz.
No, right. Mike, he's going to break out dancing in a minute, bro. And you're closest to be his partner. That's awesome.
So I now go to, for the next 6 years, it takes me to finish my PhD in criminology. Meanwhile, I'm teaching dance and making a stupid amount of money because I'm only charging $5 a person, but I'm teaching 400 to 600 students at a time.
Wow.
My classes outgrew the student ballroom. I had to rent a skating ring in Tallahassee to teach classes on Sunday night. I was on TV on commercials for different sponsors, you know, do the Lindy's for Lindy's Fried Chicken. I taught our governor Bob Graham, who became Senator Graham.
Yeah.
I would go to the governor's mansion and teach him how to do the Cotton Eye Joe and country dancing, because by this time, Urban Cowboy had come out.
Oh, my God.
So meanwhile, the faculty at FSU are losing their minds because they've never had anyone like me before.
Amen.
And, and they're trying to sort of push me out because I'm getting... Cotton Eye Joe. I'm totally self-sufficient at this point. You know, my parents are thrilled, and and I'm close to getting a PhD, and I'm on TV and at the Governor Square Mall and teaching the governor and the Speaker of the House, Ralph Haben, and you know, I'm a celebrity in town. I'm the John Revolting of Tallahassee. Now, we're gonna have a disco moment here.
There we go.
At this point, I finally, by the way, when I do my dissertation, it is on prison violence, on the architecture of prison violence, architectural determinism, which sort of comes into play later as I started getting involved in my CPTED and security career. I spent time at four prisons in Florida, including Rayford and Florida State Prison, which is death row. I actually interviewed Ted Bundy as one of my survey instruments, and I had been at Florida State University when Ted Bundy had gone to the Chi Omega house and killed the sorority sisters there, which was a CPTED moment because he went from the bar was called The First, right next to the Chi Omega house. He went into a fire exit door that had been propped open with a rock because, you know, the boyfriends of the girls would come up there and visit in the house. Well, now, you know, all of a sudden, now you had, Deathmaster 2000 walking up into the house and killing and biting and, you know, killing these several of the sorority sisters. And, of course, our campus was in absolute panic and lockdown. And I actually got to have a chance to work a little bit with Ken Katsaris, who was the sheriff of our county at that time. And we have since crossed paths years later as expert witnesses, you know, and he told me about, you know, how my name had come up because I was making suggestions about, you know, how has this happened and how do you break into the Chi Omega house? And there was one of my dance students had gotten assaulted by Ted Bundy in a house just down the street. She lived, but her name, Cheryl, he had come into a back door that was not properly secured. It had jalousie windows. And I had gone to a party at her house just weeks earlier saying, you need to secure that back door. Well, you know, meanwhile, you know, Deathstalker walks in and clubs her over the head. And she was a wonderful ballet dancer. She lost her hearing and was forever impaired because of that attack. Fortunately, she survived. The other girls didn't. Now, fast forward, I graduate from Florida State, and I'm working for architecture firms that are designing jails and prisons and courthouses around the country. I eventually moved back to South Florida, working for a design firm in 1984, and worked on the design of a 1,000-man direct supervision jail in Miami-Dade County, which was the first direct supervision jail in that county, which is a concept of having a corrections officer directly in the housing unit with inmates, as compared to behind glass or in a control room. And we call that indirect supervision as compared to direct supervision. If there's a fight, the officer gets to step in directly and tamp down the egos and the fight and, you know, whatever, in order to maintain security, safety, and keep the threshold of violence. And as a result, you can design a more commercial grade living environment as compared to a typical detention grade environment with bars and, you know, long corridors and things of that nature. So I was using the skills that I've been taught in college at the National Clearinghouse and my CPTED training for designing safer and more secure jails that looked more attractive like commercial facilities. In fact, the jail that I worked on had won many design awards back in the early 80s. Fast forward, after a couple of years working in a firm, I opened up my own practice, and I've been on my own since like 1988 as Atlas Safety and Security. I started teaching a CPTED course at the different universities, Florida International and Florida Atlantic University, by the early 90s. And for, you know, the last 15 to 20 years, I've been teaching CPTED for the National Crime Prevention Institute, Florida Atlantic University, and I give lectures around the country and the world on crime prevention and security design. I've had to reinvent myself because as the funding changed or diminished for designing correctional facilities or courthouses, because, you know, the emphasis changes where the money's going, then it just became, well, now schools are getting attacked, so now I'm designing school security, and how do we design safer schools? And then it was hospitals being attacked, so now how do we design safer hospitals? And then it was shopping centers getting attacked by, you know, bombs and people getting attacked in the parking lots. Meanwhile, through all this, I'm getting calls from attorneys, can I testify as an expert witness on premises security negligence cases, plaintiff and defense? And I said, sure, I can do that. Because as a PhD, I could write a report, and because I could teach, and because I taught dance, I had the skills of being able to communicate clearly verbally. So all of my background came to play in that I was an effective communicator and a very good teacher, and the ability of combining environmental design, architecture, urban planning, sociology, criminology, criminal justice, public administration, all into a direction of a holistic environment of creating a safer, more functional ability of, you know, living, working, and playing. And so that's how I got sparked into doing my work, was through my uncle giving me that book on Oscar Newman's Defensible Space book.
Wow.
Well, there's the podcast.
Yep. Thanks for joining us, folks.
Thank you, and good night.
Yeah. Obviously, you've worked on, you know, several projects, obviously, doing this so long. So let's start with most interesting project. What, I mean, all of them are interesting, I'm sure, based on the way your brain works. But do you have one that was not necessarily your favorite, just most interesting as far as what the challenges were you were trying to overcome in that particular environment or building or what space?
Well, it varies. That I've had some very, very interesting expert witness cases that I've been testifying on that have, you know, murder cases or people that have been seriously injured or assaulted that had architectural impacts, you know, people going to their cars getting attacked and the lighting was out or they trip over a wheel stop. There's been one of the cases was a murder case in New Jersey where four college kids were murdered and assaulted by MS-13 gang members in the elementary school parking lot. And it was the perfect storm of, because the school had left the gates open, the fence gates open, even though it was their policy procedure to close the gates on weekends. I mean, it's well known. I mean, elementary schools can have computers and expensive equipment, so we know schools get vandalized. So you want to lock the schools when it's the end of the night so the janitorial people can come in there and clean. And during the summer when things are winding down, there aren't students or teachers there or anyone to challenge, you know, what are you doing here? Stop spray painting or vandalizing the school or breaking the glass or whatever. That was a really profound case because the fact that had just one simple security measure been done, which is just to close the gate that was there, it would have changed the entire timeline for these kids going into the parking lot. And the fact that the MS-13 gang members who lived in an apartment building just a block away would go into this play area and vandalize it, start fires, do gang graffiti and tagging, shoot up in the air. And they had cut holes in the fence so they could come through effortlessly into the school property. Of course, the fences had never been repaired. The lighting wasn't working. The cameras weren't working. And the fences and the gates were left open.
Wow, perfect. That is a perfect storm.
So that was an example of what I talked about today about, you know, did you create, promote, or allow an event to happen?
Yep.
They created, promoted, and allowed it to happen. And as a result, three of those young people got shot and macheted to death, and one of them got shot and macheted and amazingly lived to be able to testify against these gang members who were ultimately sentenced to prison for life.
Animals. You can call them animals.
And it was just a terrible tragedy. That was probably one of the most interesting expert cases I've worked on. As far as architecture, I've worked on some really interesting projects that have been jails. One was a consulting on a jail project in California, Northern California, where I was, as an expert, evaluating why the security systems weren't working as they had been promised to work. And the officers were having trouble communicating with their radios through the concrete, and they were supposed to, and the doors weren't opening properly. And there were some real serious issues that officers could get hurt or killed and or inmates. And we had to go through and evaluate the technology and the design. And one of my favorite moments was going into an electrical closet, and it was all stacked up with the different black boxes of the different electronic equipment. And right above it in this utility closet was a water sprinkler head.
Yeah, of course.
And so had, you know, any of the inmates started, you know, a little fire or something and the sprinklers went off, it would have literally shorted out a huge majority of the electronics of this entire correctional facility.
Yeah.
What? So I find, so when I talked about earlier today about how the reason that I'm so cynical and sarcastic is because I'm surrounded by incompetence, it's not because I'm just hateful. It's the fact that I go into places and, but for the grace of God, you know, things just don't fall down and hurt people.
Right.
I mean, it is just shocking how, not, I want to say blinded, but not situationally aware they are of their environment.
We like to say common sense isn't a flower that grows in everyone's garden.
That's well said. Tom, he's holding back because basically all Tom wants to do when you're sitting there going off is say amen, because all these things that you're, I don't say complaining about, making awesome statements about have come out of this dude's mouth. You know, they're a technology company. They do access control, cameras, gunshot detection, facial recognition, analytics. Now they're doing mobile temperature scanning for people. You know, they are a solutions company. So a lot of times by
the time. Is that where you bend over while you're walking?
They, we do not do they have, that
they,
part.
That, I think that's a prototype that's currently in design.
Yeah, we'll let somebody else test that one.
Well, we told Steven as part of the project manager of the temperature.
Is that why we're all wearing gloves and masks now?
Exactly.
Thank God there's a camera, so nobody thinks we're wearing gloves and masks right now. But Tom, a lot of times by the time they're brought in or they're brought in to fix somebody else's problem, or I'm brought in as a consultant to do an assessment and find another company's problems, and I'm like, you need to talk to Herring, because I went through a lot of other contractors, providers, if you will, before I landed here to find these guys and find somebody that does it right and understands the process and understands all of it. And I'll let Tom hit on, you know, you, like a client calls you and says, I need cameras. What's the first thing you tell them?
Do you have an assessment? You know, has anyone come in, taken a look? Do you have a plan? And I want to give credit where credit's due. Back when we were starting, I actually attended one of Randy's classes, and he didn't even realize that until today in Denver. And we toured the Coors facility, the manufacturing plant.
And the number one thing that I talked about in that class was you always start with the risk threat vulnerability assessment. What's the problem? Problem seeking versus problem solving. And my experience, you know, as the person that specifies security technology equipment, is that people throw money shamelessly at the problem.
Oh, my God.
But they don't take the 10% that they're throwing into the actual purchase of mechanical equipment and say, is anyone watching the cameras? What are you watching?
What are you?
And my profound question, so what? Who cares? You know, are you making a difference with controlling access or watching something, or is it just that you're, because someone else is doing it, you think you have to do it? Case point, the Port of Miami got a federal DHS grant, Paul, and they put in an entirely new video system in the Port of Miami. So, and I heard this through the rumblings underground, and now all of a sudden I'm like, well, where is the risk assessment? Well, we don't need no stinking risk assessment. We just will throw money shamelessly at the problem because we know that there's a potential terrorist attack against our cruise ships, and we have to protect the cargo containers and things of that nature. So we'll just put in $5 or $7 million for video surveillance. What are you watching? The porpoises swim down the cut, which is our waterways around the port. So I appreciate the technology, but you always have to start off with asking, what do you want, and what is the technology going to do, and what is your end game?
Well, exactly, and that's one of the things that if I've heard it once, I've heard it 100 times, they call us and they're like, hey, I've got a $35,000 budget here for cameras. Oh, okay.
That'll buy you 4 cameras.
Yeah, I was like, are you going to make a movie? What are you going to do? And so the first thing we ask, what's your assessment? What is your end game? What's your problem first? Yeah. What are you trying to prevent? The second thing is, we always want to know exactly, for every camera that goes up, what is your purpose for that specific camera? Because that's what determines where it's put. What's its quality? What does it do?
And what height it's placed at?
Yeah, what height?
I mean, are you watching night vision or day vision?
Correct.
Are you doing license plate recognition with cameras, or are you watching people faces and you're trying to determine if it's people who belong on the property, or you're actually people counting for evacuation purposes for fire? I mean, so there's lots of good questions to ask, and the client typically assumes that the company who has a vested interest in making money and profit, who wants to come in with the cheapest equipment possible, the cheapest labor possible, get in and out as quickly as possible, they don't want to spend the extra $15,000, $20,000, $30,000 of labor to write up a report saying, we need to have this kind of camera at the entrance, we need to have this kind of camera in the parking lot, we need to have this kind of entrance in the back recreation areas or the pool or whatever it might be, because we need to tie in motion sensing devices in the pool, so in case a child gets back there, it creates an alarm condition that, no, people should not be in the university pool after 7 o'clock at night.
We talk about this a lot on this, but technology makes people feel better when they see it. They can process it. They can see, oh, more cameras. There are multiple schools, especially private schools, that specifically after Parkland, Florida happened, they threw a bunch of money at the problem and said, give me 25 more cameras. And what in the crap are 25 more cameras going to do for your campus in that situation, except make the parents feel better that are pulling on campus and they see those 25 more cameras? If we're not changing policies or what we're doing or how we're using those cameras or how we're training people or something like that, we just throw money at it because it's a private school and we put a bunch more technology up that people can see, it makes them feel better, and you've done nothing. You've done nothing to make the campus safer.
And throwing money shamelessly at the problem doesn't make the problem go away.
Right.
And makes it a more expensive problem.
Yep. And in some regards, it actually creates more liability because, if you're putting in this technology, access control, cameras, public address systems, badging systems, whatever, identification card systems, it now creates a sense of notice and foreseeability. But if you don't have an actual mapped out plan that the cameras are part of an access control, which is part of visitor identification, which is part of notification, which is part of being able to respond in case of an event that occurs, now you have a plan, and the video and the analytics and the access control and the technology systems are part of the plan. It's not the plan.
Yep. Absolutely. It's a piece of the puzzle. It is not the puzzle. It's a piece. And Brink, you and I have talked about it over and over. Yes, as one that sells it, I should be wanting to sell more. Generally, we cut cameras down from what their original is. Access control, you discussed it today, your primary point of entrance, limiting those points of entry to where you can control them. That's something that people leave out they get a budget and they want to spend it so fast. And I'm going to pick on Paul a little bit about universities, but
For the people that can't see, Paul's in the room. We're not just talking about some random dude that's not in here. He's just behind the camera. Yeah.
But university, you know, it's hard to come up for budgets for security sometimes. When they do get it, it's like, we got to go right now and spend all of it, or it's going to get taken away.
Because it's in this year's fiscal plan.
Correct.
You use it or you lose it.
Correct.
And because it's not part of a security master plan, that we're going to put in new lighting this year, and then we're going to put in the conduits. We put in conduits, and then we put in the lighting, and then we run the lines for IP for cameras or access control or whatever it might be.
Communication between the buildings.
I mean, if you don't have the infrastructure, all the technology is not going to be very helpful. But it's all part of a step A, B, C, D, E. And the challenge I run into is everyone wants to get to E, and they haven't done the A, which is to ask the questions, what's the problem?
Correct. And I wish Jim had some angel music over there playing of saying amen of the point you just made. It's you can't throw money at problems without a plan.
And that's a perfect
segue. You can, but you're not going to solve it.
Well, and that's a perfect segue to what's happening right now. You know, so are we out of time?
No, we're good. No, not at all.
I just had Mr. Burns from The Simpsons open up the trap door. Release the house. which is we're dealing with now a different threat, a biological threat, and whether it was man-made in China or just came out of eating bats or whatever it came from, a marketplace where they just weren't doing proper sanitary healthcare procedures. The why isn't as important is that we now have a medical challenge, public health emergency on a global level. And there's been all sorts of books and movies written about this for years, for decades. You know, my favorites, of course, are Z Nation, the V Wars. There was on Netflix, The Vampire Wars, where, again, a virus gets released out of the ice from the Ice Age, and we don't have any immunity or tolerance for it. So now we have a new biological threat that is threatening the world, but somehow 90-something percent of the people have little or no impact or don't get sick or get a minor cold from it, but that couple of percent that is vulnerable gets real sick and are very vulnerable to getting the virus takes over their body and kills them badly. Now the question is, what is the highest good? How do we protect that very vulnerable few? And what we found in just the last month, that it's not just old people like me in their 60s, between 60 and death, it's
funny. I'm turning 50 next week.
Now all of a sudden in Florida, where it is growing exponentially, I just saw on the news here, we had over 10,000 reported positive tests today alone. I mean, it is growing exponentially in Florida, mostly because the young people that are going out don't feel that it's a threat to them, so they're having parties, and that's why we had to close down the beaches for July 4th weekend. But you see the pictures from the Ozarks where all the kids are in the pool together, and they're going on the protests, and they're going to the parties, and they're going to the bars. So here I am in Nashville on July 8th, and I've been to Nashville before, and I love Nashville. It's a wonderful city and great bars, great music, great food. Really fun people. It's a beautiful city, and I love blues music. I love country music. I love barbecue. I mean, so I am just like a hog in mud. and now you've gone back to like phase one or phase two, and half the bars on Broadway are closed. And the few bars that were open that had music, they could only have two or three members playing in the band, and they all had to be wearing masks. So now they're singing, going,
oh, I love that country music.
what did you say? I can't hear it.
Sounds muffled like through the old speakers.
Yeah,
right.
And I'm sitting in a stool having a drink, served by someone in personal protection equipment, trying to get a rum and coke. And it's like, I feel like I'm in a biological lab. I feel like, where the doctor comes in and like, would you like to bend over and cough? I mean, what is going on here? What is, so then myself and my wife, who, because I'm a dancer, so we're starting to do West Coast swing to some of the great country music and blues music I heard last night at BB King. Excuse me, sir, you're going to have to sit down. There's no dancing here. Well, those are fighting words where I come from. You know, so we're seeing that there's a direct impact in this biological threat, and how does that impact in the school world, which is what the focus of today's talk was, which is, as we speak, literally in time, real time, the president is threatening the rest of the country that you will offer school in person in fall in 4 weeks, or we'll take away your funding. Figure it out. The kids are young. They'll survive. The rest of us might not. The teachers might not. But the kids, you know, because they're kids, you can't kill them. They adapt. They assimilate.
They're resilient.
They're resilient. Yeah. That's the word I was looking for. Thank you.
And they don't even eat dirt anymore. But
mine did.
That's the way we grew up. So.
Yeah.
So now, how do we screen people coming into our facilities to determine if, in fact, they're healthy or not? How do we protect the teachers? How do we space the kids with the spatial distancing? How do we do effective access control? How do we make all the access control frictionless and touchless? You know, because our architecture, furnishings, and fixtures aren't designed that way. You pull a handle. You have to close it with something. Now, many of the storefronts and malls have doors that open up automatically with a motion sensor, but that's not what you typically find in school environments because that's expensive hardware.
How do you do lunch?
Yeah, well, you're going to have to do like the airplanes now or like the hotel. I'm at the Hilton here in downtown Nashville, which is a beautiful property. The executive lounge, there's no buffets. You have a little bag with, some M&Ms and some nuts, and there's a refrigerator there with, some sodas. But even that, you have to open up the door of the refrigerator.
Exactly.
You're touching the bottles. Oh, I don't want this Coke. I want that bottle. Now I've done a cross-contamination. The restaurants, I went to a restaurant in downtown on Broadway here last night, which was really handled it well. When I came into this restaurant, it could be a restaurant, a store, it could be a school, it could be going into the science building of the university here. I came in, they had to check my temperature. Then they gave me a paper menu. Then they escorted me. The hostess had a mask on and gloves. Walked me to our table, sat us down. We could finally take off our masks because we're sitting at the table and not moving around, not touching anything. Our silverware was brought covered in paper that we opened up. Water was poured, in a glass with a server that had gloves on. I mean, so now we're talking about a lot of expense. We're talking about training for the staff, which goes back to the training issue, policy and procedures, and half the table. So here we are on a Tuesday night at this beautiful gourmet restaurant in downtown Nashville, and there was seven people in that entire dining room at 8 o'clock at night, which would normally, we've been here before, is jam-packed. Waiting room only.
Yep.
How are they going to survive? How is this server going to make enough money? Even if I tip well, it's just not enough. How are they? And now that Nashville's gone back a click, how is these restaurants going to survive being in lockdown for another 4 weeks, 6 weeks without any income coming in or enough income coming in to pay for the purveyors and the refrigeration and the training and all the paper and the cleaning supplies and It really is a shocking situation. So the architecture of schools is going through yet another revolution.
Yep.
About how do we create a safe environment for the kids, primarily, of course, the teachers and the administration, and then the delivery of goods and services. How do you handle recreation in the yard? I mean, how do you do that when you can't play ball? You can't use the monkey bars.
Well, how do you focus on COVID and the response for that and not take your eye off the ball for the all hazards approach, right? Not just design, but response, training, and everything else. I mean, we've taken our eye off the ball in this country because right now the news cycle is dominated by politics, protests, and pandemics. Meanwhile, week before last, over a 4-day period, there were 4 active shooter attacks in this country, and nobody's heard about any of them because again, we're dominated by all this stuff, right? So I want to back up because we covered a lot there on two things. One, shameless plug, because I don't work here, but one of the solutions for people getting back to work in schools is doing mass surface temperature scanning, which is just a step. It's not a solution. But Tom has built a platform out that's server-based, which is phenomenal. They'll scan up to 30 people at a time walking in front of the camera and alert if your temperature's over 100.4. Great. So problems come up and solutions get created, right? I mean, and that's what's going on here. The other thing, when you talked about cameras, Tom calls them popcorn cameras, the ones where people just throw money at it, throw a bunch of cameras up, and then you just sit back with a bag of popcorn and watch your cameras, because what are you looking at? Nothing.
Yeah.
People have got to focus on, again, back to your point, what is the problem? What are we trying to solve? Let's do that first, whether it's a safety, like COVID time, or a security time. Don't take our eye off the ball because we're so focused on one, we can't focus on the other. But I think that's what's going on. I think that's exactly what's happening right now all across this country. People are taking their eye off the ball because of everything that's dominating the news cycle.
Well, one of the things that scares me to death, and Randy mentioned it during his presentation today, you're talking about the contactless door openings.
Yep.
So what are people going to do? They're propping the doors open.
Darn right.
Well, yeah. Guess what else they're doing? They're propping them open. We're being required to wear masks. Do you realize it's a felony to carry a firearm while you wear a mask?
Yeah.
I'm breaking the law, P.S.
And whether it be a bank, and whether it be a bank or an apartment building or a restaurant or a school, university, if I can't see who you are and the cameras can't record who you are because you're wearing a mask for public safety and for not spreading your germs, how do you, and you're making a police officer is making a car stop, and you're wearing a mask, or you need to put on a mask when the officer comes up to the window and he's going to be wearing a mask. And so now everyone's walking around like, the Lone Ranger. I mean, it's nuts. And it goes back to the question, what is the highest good here? Clearly public health will typically trump almost everything, because when you have a plague, whether it be mumps or typhoid or SARS, name your public health challenge. That's something that hits everybody equally. This is not about race. It's not about color. It's not about your sexual preference. It's not about your height. Now it may be about medical issues. It may be if you have high blood pressure, or you have asthma, or it may be that you have heart disease. So yes, it's going to pick the weaker of the herd. So this may be ultimately the giant thinning of the herd. As one possible, because when you think of past pandemics like the Black Plague and things of that nature, the 1920-18 Spanish flu, millions of people lost. We, living right here, right now, are a living proof product that we are survivors of people who survived that generation. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here.
Right.
Exactly.
But that doesn't mean that we're not literally one click away from being dinosaurs, that we finally get something that just takes out the entire humanoid race.
Oh, sure. Certainly. Yeah. Then who knows, right? And that's the problem right now. Nobody knows. Nobody knows what tomorrow holds with this thing. Nobody knows what the next week looks like. Of course, all of us with a lick of common sense could have predicted the spike in cases because, hello, people started just completely ignoring social distancing, started having protests. Yeah. The people that wear their mask like down here around their chin and only kind of partially cover their mouth and not their nose at all. I'm like, or
well, my favorite picture on that exact note was posted in the west coast of Florida. There was a commissioner, a city council person, one of the meetings. He's sitting back in his chair with the mask over his eyes, sound asleep. Most appropriate use of mask yet.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, the times are, just crazy. And each week when we're doing this podcast, there's so much content to talk about because of everything that's happening. But at the end of the day, everybody sitting at this table anyway, wants to focus on solutions to whatever the problems are. And the problems are going to be ever-evolving, ever-changing. And so we, as providers, consultants, technology companies, solutions companies, designers, need to evolve with it. And obviously, Randy, you have. Your story, like I said, we just sat back and pulled your string, and wow, right? Like, oh, my God. I was like, is this going to stop?
Well, thank you for the opportunity of speaking today. I appreciate it. And I hope that it's bringing a little bit of awareness to your listeners. And I would just submit for your consideration that for those of you who are old enough to remember Star Trek or the new Star Trek shows that are out now, that the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few or the one. And it's important to go back to the basics, that we look for protecting as much of the herd as we can. And there'll always be the weak or the elderly that, or the frail or the fragile, or, that will, get eaten by the alligator or the lion. That's, we see the nature shows. They have to eat too. Equal opportunity. But this is not divisive. This is not exclusive. This is inclusive. Everyone is vulnerable, because if you don't take care of yourself, you make yourself more vulnerable to getting sick. If you become sick, you expose the people in your family who you do care for, assuming that all the selfish young people care for someone other than themselves and taking selfies.
Right.
Sarcasm added.
Yes. Duly noted. You're right. And I can't echo that enough. I think who knows what the future holds as far as all this goes, but everybody can do something to contribute to solving this problem. I mean, there's no doubt, right? I mean, everybody can take steps. Everybody can do certain things. And just, again, be cognizant and give a crap about other people, right? I mean,
I think
without going overboard.
What you're talking about here is that crime prevention through environmental design, which is my very small slice of the world of expertise, is a course of consequences. I actually
don't forget
use that.
Ballroom dancing.
Well, yes.
All right.
But even ballroom dancing, you've got to learn how to work with your partner. Otherwise, you step on their feet and you break your female partner's nails and toes, and it's a very long drive home, believe me.
I bet.
It's a really long drive home of frontal lobe attacks, like, you know, the rat studies.
Yes.
You know. Oh, yeah. It's, you know, kill me now. Quickly, not with COVID. And so it's a course of consequences. How do we create the highest good, which is that we thrive as a city, we thrive as a family, we thrive as a country, and the divisiveness that's going on here, it's imperative that you look deeper under the surface of what is the intentions and motivations of the people that are screaming, the squeaky wheels that are screaming the loudest here, what's their agendas? And when you look at the silent majority who are just trying to get by and trying to figure out how to get their job back and how to pay their medical bills and pay their mortgage and rent and take care of their children or their parents or whatever, doing the best that they can, they don't have a selfish agenda. They are being selfless, not selfish. And it's imperative that, you know, we try to pass that motivation on to these next generations, because they're so busy of looking at themselves in the mirror and in their phones that they don't realize that there's consequences for not wearing a mask. They think it's their constitutional right to not wear a mask. No, you know, building codes are very strict. Fire codes are very strict. You can't go into a movie theater and scream fire. You'll get arrested and you'll cause a riot and people stampede out and people die because of something like that. You can't walk into a restaurant without shoes on. It's a public safety health code. So if I can't go into a restaurant not wearing shoes and a shirt, or I get no service, why can't I go into a restaurant without a mask on in this couple of months that Dr. Fauci has been pleading and groveling on, saying, just can we get a little bit of cooperation for a couple of months and we'll get a handle on this? We're now almost in South Florida. Our emergency rooms and our intensive care units are in the 90%+. I mean, that means one more click up and there are no more beds to take care of people, no more ventilators. We're right back where we started 4 months ago. So it's not that they're ending phase one, we're in phase two. We have literally just kicked all the hard effort and all of the pain and suffering we've gone through financially and as a country and work has been for naught, because literally we are worse now than we were 4 months ago.
Well, again, back to what's our focus what do we try and do every day, and that is solve problems for our clients or help them solve problems, and how to live safely in what I call a dangerously developing world. And that was pre-COVID. I mean, this world is dangerously developing all the time, so we've got to evolve with it, period, end of story, whatever that looks like. Tom is a solutions-based company for technology, right? I consult, primarily do training. You do a lot, oh my god, but we're all part of this same solution, and we all want to be part of the same solution. I do want to tip a hat real quick to THEC, Tennessee Higher Education Commission, who did the webinar earlier today, because even in the world of COVID, when things, you know, when people lose their minds and for whatever reason cannot multitask and focus on anything except, you know, oh my God, wear a mask and wash your hands. Great. Can we do anything else at the same time? Well, THEC said, yes, we're going to focus on the broader safety and security of our campuses. Even during this, even after the state building shut down and we have to reroute the webinar to Herring Technology. So hats off, Tom. Thanks for letting us have it here, because this thing would have been dead in the water without the location to do it. That's just the reality. But THEC is the one who said, we're going to push forward. This is important, and it is important. And I think there's not a lot of organizations out there that would continue, push this thing, make it happen, even though we had to make adjustments. Obviously, you and I both ran into some technical issues. We all did today. That's fine. That's the world of COVID. At the end of the day, we want to get the information out because we want to help people, right?
And the schools need to open.
Amen, brother.
We've got to get, I mean, you know, the poor parents are stuck having to teach the kids at home. They've got to go back to work.
Right.
Imagine what society's going to be like when this generation gets up with the parents doing the teaching.
Oh, Lord. Especially with me. But
yeah, that's what anyway.
Again, thank you very much. And much
yeah, no, this was like enlightening and entertaining as hell to listen to you talk because your story is phenomenal. It was a lot of fun, so I look forward to more. But, guys, thanks for listening to this edition of Tips, Tactics, and Tools for a Safer Tomorrow. You can always find us on Facebook, Twitter. You can reach out to us at tipstactictools.com.
I'm out.